Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the process of yogification, and like sort of Sandeep clarified that yogification is referring to yoga only. It's just the process of yoga. To make it easier, we've called it yogification. Later today, we will be seeing the four streams of yoga identified by Swami Vivekananda. And actually, by no means does it mean that there are only four ways of yogification. I think in the scriptures it is said that Adi Yogi, who actually was the founder of yoga, created 108 ways, you know, corresponding to all of our different chakras. What Swami Vivekananda did was actually just systematize these and in some ways classify these into four broad streams, which we will be working on through the course. But before coming into the streams, let's just understand some of these features. Let's understand what is the goal, the state that they're all working towards. What is the broad contour of the journey that they take us through? And what is the movement between the field and the sva? And this question was coming up yesterday, right? I think Priya had asked this. So can I access my Anandamay, my Vigyanamay course directly? So we talk of this field, which is your Annamay, Pranamay, Manomay kosh, and the three gunas. And you want to go inside. But how do you go inside? Is there a way for the inside to come out and reveal itself? So we'll talk a little bit about this also. I think the goal, no, I think for me, this visual is the simplest of all, that these are four streams merging into the same ocean of Kevali, of Yoga, of Anand. And so even though they may look very different, they're all working towards a common goal. And in fact, each of them really support each other also on this path. So the goal is the same. The means may look different, but let's understand what the means look like. So this is the same chart from the previous one. For ease, for simplicity, we're just removing all the words and putting these three words that we may use interchangeably to denote the goal: yoga, swa, or Anandamay kosh. So when it comes to the journey that these four streams take us through, there are some aspects that are common across streams. And what is common? The first is that the person who is learning is you. I think that we all know is common. What is also common is that the subject is you. So you are learning by experimenting. And you are the person who actually experiments. Now, what you experiment on, the object may be different. And actually, this is quite a departure from the way research typically is done these days. You have a different learner who is the researcher. The subject, who is the person who's implementing, is different. And the object is, you know, we know other humans, rats, and other creatures. But here, I think this is very, very different, very unique about this process. Let's see what is unique. Object on which you are actually, we try the yogification process, is also you, but it's a unit or a whole unit within that you work with. And I understand these two new words are coming out, so we'll go through this. Actually, on this slide, you'll see a lot of terminology, new terminology coming in, which is not from the text. Let me clarify that. This is our way of understanding, interpreting this. And a lot of this terminology will become clear when we apply it to Gyan Yoga. But I'll just introduce the concept to start with. So what is this whole unit? This is the subjective experience of swa at Vigyanamay Kosh level. So like we saw yesterday, that the experience of swa will be very different for different people because it will be influenced by who we are, our field. Yesterday itself, we all had different experiences coming out, which, whether it was a color, an image. So all of those could be subjective experiences of swa. Peace, that we actually is going to be an anchor for today, is one such subjective experience. What is the whole unit? The whole unit is how the whole unit manifests at the field level, now that it is under the influence of the trigunas and the three koshas. So for example, if we take in the whole unit love, pure, and we need to these days qualify to say pure love, because the word love has very different connotations. So if you were to take pure love as the whole unit, the way it manifests in our field is through different emotions. It's that love which, when you know, influenced by rajas, or when influenced by tamas, for example, which is around restraining, may actually give rise to possessiveness. It may give rise to anger when our desire is not met, which is rajas. So this unit will manifest itself in some, I would say, maybe some distorted forms at the field level. But it's that whole unit itself which is shining through. What happens is, because of that, some dualities get created in our experience of the unit in that field. So love and hate, not the pure love, but love and hate, pleasure and pain, good and bad. If you're coming from, you know, this conscience may lead to good and bad, these subjectivities, these pluralities, these dualities. Also, there are some laws. So this is a science at the end of the day. So the unit is governed by certain laws. How does the unit function? How does it relate to the other units? How is it related to the other, koshas? All of those are the laws that are governing. And what we have is also, we've been given certain technology, certain tools which are based on these laws through which we can manipulate the unit. And this is the question I think that Ramaswamy was also asking yesterday. Can you actually shift the expression of the prakriti, which is your trigun, for example? And it is possible to change that expression. We know today that it is possible to change the expression of the genes within a few weeks, within a few months. So yes, all that we see in the field and therefore in the unit is alterable if we go by these laws. So if you put all of this together, I think what this might look like, and again, this will become much more practical in the next section, is broadly this. As an engineer, we used to seeing tables and creating one. So these are four streams that we'll be working with. And in each stream, systematically over the course, what we will do is to talk about how we understand what's the whole unit, the unit, the laws, the tools, the dualities. And this just is a table that gets populated. What we do is actually each stream also offers many, many, many tools, you know, many, many things. So what we will in this course is to choose one object. Like I said, it could be the whole unit that you work with. So for example, you may choose to work with love, how it really in its true meaning. And that would be meaning that would say that you're working with the whole unit. And that's what you work with through the course. Or you could work with a manifestation of that love. That could also be a chosen object. So in this course, we have suggested certain objects to sort of work with, experiment with, and we're also trying to ensure some diversity so that we all understand and get some breadth also. The next thing I'm going to talk of is in the yogification, what is this movement between the field and the swa? And you'll see this over here, there are two arrows, right? So there is a way to actually go inside, and there is a way to go outside. And both these movements are possible to do. So we are thinking of these as, we think of these as inward, which is an outside in process, and an outward process, which is an inside out process. Let's understand each of these briefly. In an inward in process, what we do is we are harmonizing the pluralities, the multiple dualities in our experience. Like you saw in the slide that Sandeep showed, there is a good, bad, pleasant, unpleasant. So we actually work with each of these and try to slowly, slowly harmonize them, integrate them into that place. So you're moving from pluralities towards that kevalya, towards the wholeness, and moving from the field. Like Sandeep talked of his practices, that those practices enabled him to reach a place where it was not the trigun or these koshas that was so influencing him. He could actually then start listening to the cosmic intelligence. An analogy that I think really like is, and we learn this mantra in Surya Namaskar also, that satya sya pihitam mukham, which is said that it's like jo surya hai, if that is being covered by clouds, you know, doesn't mean surya nahi hai. And this process is just about actually removing those clouds jo hamare surya ko cover kar rahe hai, so that we can see the cosmic light. And I want to simplify this. Hopefully, Sandeep had a good suggestion. The other Sandeep, Bhatlavande, had a good suggestion. So I'm going to try and simplify this, not in terms of the four streams, but in very practical things that we have done or we, you know, can do. If you think is ahar, vyayam, and vichar, these are the three things that we do in Sanjeevani. And these are the three things I think we've all experimented with at some point of time. So broadly, when we work with our food, we're trying to work with our annamay kosh, though it influences all the koshas, but broadly, you know, food works on, ahar works on annamay kosh. Vyayam is essentially a pranic manipulation. You're working on your pranamay kosh through vyayam. And vichar is, you know, we're working on our manomay kosh. So when you start focusing and saying, okay, what is healthy, what is unhealthy, when you start building that discrimination, that's when we're actually doing an outside in process to understand, okay, this is good, this is bad, this is how it should be. And that's, and when you eat that food, then you actually start seeing shifts in your body. Okay, actually, this is what it does to me. And that builds our confidence more. Vidyayam, when it's doing these practices, you know, when we do a yoga practice, just the process of doing that practice itself, both stimulation and relaxation, brings a certain ease within our body. It makes the diseases disappear, makes us swasth, so that again, we can actually listen to the true knowledge within. In vichar, something, this is something I did a lot. I did this extensively, I think for 1 year of my practice, you know, when I was learning to work with my emotions, is to explore every single thing. That if something happened that made me angry, what was the reason behind it? What need of mine was unfulfilled? And then going deeper, deeper, and initially it is all over the place because, you know, everything triggers one. And then you're trying to find, okay, isse ye need hai, isse ye need hai. But slowly, slowly, I started seeing patterns in my own needs. Anger was a very dominant emotion for me. And so I started seeing, you know, there are different patterns that these are my needs. These are 5, 6 needs or maybe 10 needs. Then actually comes a stage of even going deeper, that beneath the needs, there are certain values, there are certain fears that are much, much more fundamental. And so that starts simplifying it. What seems like, you know, 100 different triggers at the end of the day now starts boiling down to this one or two things. You know, so for me, for example, this the one core fear that it keeps boiling down to is my self-worth, me feeling that I'm not doing enough, or it comes from this lack of self-worth. And that sort of simplifies the process. It makes it complex and hard also, but it, you know, in some ways it is, that's the process of merging, harmonizing the pluralities until it leads us to the cosmic intelligence. The other process, which is the outward inside out process, is actually anchoring all experiences in our wholeness. So you're moving from the wholeness, and from that wholeness, seeing how do I see the pluralities from this space. So actually accessing the cosmic intelligence, because actually, like we said yesterday, that cosmic intelligence is available right here, right now, in this moment. It is in our body, it's in our breath, it's in our manomay kosh. We just need to access it. So this is about really staying anchored in that. A few examples that I can take is when it comes to food, and this is something we do a lot at Sanjeevani, this thing of activity, of this thing of eating mindfully. It may seem like a tool, but it's actually not a tool, which is an inward tool. Eating mindfully is essentially about tuning into silence, because when we are silent, we can listen to the body signals. We are not judging it. And that shifts what we eat, how much we eat. We no longer need to rely on information from what a nutritionist is telling us, you know, or what a book says, ketna khana chahiye. Your body speaks to you. This is an inside out process. In vyayam, you know, I can do all these practices, but when I cultivate my willpower, which is the ability to change, you know, that not only helps me shift my body, it helps me regulate my prana, it helps me regulate many other things in life. So cultivating willpower, for example, is an example of working, is an inside out process. and which are, I think this is again something that from my lived experience has really, really supported me, to anchor in love. So there is an outside-in process. I can go out, you know, analyzing as many icebergs, or I can just say all of this is a distortion of love, and can I anchor myself in love at all times, like we did with peace today? And this, each of these processes will finally again have the same goal, which is for us to be in touch with our cosmic intelligence. So here's what the four streams of yoga delineated by Swami Vivekananda, and his words are, I think, really powerful, can evoke different reactions and responses within us also. But here goes. We saw yesterday how he said, each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to manifest this divinity within by controlling nature, external and internal. And these words didn't make sense to me up until some time ago, up until very recently. What is this nature, external and internal? What is this control? Because again, we have our own connotations of control. But this nature is the gunas, is the prakriti, is the panchakosh, that is our nature, external and internal. Do this either by work or worship or psychic control or philosophy, by one or more or all of these, and be free. Kevalya, moksha. This is the whole of religion, doctrines or dogmas, or rituals, or books, or temples, or forms are but secondary details. I'm just taking half a minute. Just look at this, let it sink in.